Mikey, I am beyond honored. When we were talking in preparation for this chat, we were like, blah, 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 blah. This is going to be so easy. So we're going to, like, you know, yabber right. on, and then you guys will just be here witnessing it. First of all, I said to Psyche, I said, where does your name come from? Because we have to start there. Right? Don't you guys write that name? Okay.
Made it up.
As we do in our neighborhoods and communities.
My dad is a theologian, as I explained, and my sisters and I all have Greek-derived names. So I was fortunate to be blessed with Psyche, and all through middle school and elementary school, of course, I was teased. Are you psychic? You know, all of that. So, you know, I've learned to live with it. So
it's a strong name, and I feel like, you know, one becomes their name, because with that name you had to do something great.
Well, I'm trying to make my mark on the world.
Yeah. So let me start just by asking. So, just jumping right in, everybody. So, given the political and social importance of the Civil War, why should we focus on what was eaten during and after the battle?
Right, right. That's a really good question. I put together a couple of slides because I think that those help to speak to this importance. Can we dim the lights a little? Is it possible to dim? You know, over the weekend, of course, those who have been in attendance have heard lots of good conversation around the political, economic, and social issues, and I see food as very much a political issue. I'm going to come back to this slide about actually what was eaten, but I've put together just a couple of images here, mostly of African-American men, because one of the things that Ta-Nehisi Coates talks about is the narrative, right? The narrative of the lost cause that leaves out, you know, African-American people. And I think that when we start looking at African-American people and culture, we have to look at it in its entirety. And we cannot leave out bits and pieces. And so the cultural actually becomes political. You see here in this image in the back, there's this African-American soldier. And he has, this is a dinner party, and he has a pitcher, right? Here also you see some, they were interesting because in some instances they functioned, it looked like, as soldiers, and in other instances they appeared to be servants in waiting. But we can read these images for the political import. This was, in some instances, the ways in which African Americans contributed to the emancipation process, mm-hmm. right? Being in these particular kinds of servant positions. But then also we know that there were many who served as spies. And the way that they were able to get and transmit information, right, was in their domestic capacity, because they get ignored, they get eclipsed, they get erased.
So spies for whom?
Spies for the Union, for the Union Army. Uh-huh. Yeah, they were able to take information. And also, I'm just gonna flip ahead and then come back, because these are in somewhat of an order, but easily I can go back. Here's an image from Harper's Weekly, 1864, of slaves helping others escape. You know, so during this time period, hearing the plans of the Confederate and other kinds of military plans, they were able to share that information with one another, right? So all of this comes through actually food spaces, because those tend to be viewed as genial, congenial, convivial. Everyone's enjoying. That's a perfect time for subterfuge.
Mm-hmm. Wow. You know, I always said that when you are sitting around a table, it is actually the perfect place for diplomacy as well, because everybody lets their guards down.
Sure.
And it's very easy to sit across from somebody that you don't like, but you can actually share food with them, because it is that ultimate just field, leveling the field, you know.
Right, right. Well, and it is, and at the same time, you know, we find that eating times are some of the most intense, mm-hmm. right? Think of holidays.
Right, oh, yeah.
And the coming together of families and so forth. I mean, you know, some of the best murder scenes occur.
Right? I was going to say, because I could always say Thanksgiving 2005 was crazy, you know, right? My family.
Exactly, so So again, I think it's, these images then become really useful for thinking about the ways in which African-American people were at this time, again, gleaning information. And this, these kinds of images really become fascinating for the sort of line of separation.
Right, right.
You see? So they were able perhaps to serve these foods, but maybe not able to eat them, you know, in many instances. There are in the WPA narrative, but also in some of the other accounts, there are stories of hunger, and we know in starvation, because of course African Americans who had escaped were considered contraband and could be resold into the South or put to work in capacities where they were hardly equal.
All right. Well, let's talk about. So here you see, I mean, during the war, and you see that these Negroes, blacks, African Americans were working, but let's talk about the emancipation and what those foods look like, and also let's talk about the importance of red foods, you know, in this, for the emancipation celebration.
Right. So when we get to emancipation foods, this is a pot of frying chicken, because of course. Chicken was an emancipation food, right? People didn't stop eating necessarily the same foods that they ate the day before. And if they could get access to something like a turkey, then they would have. You know, there are quite a few people who talk about the bread riots of Richmond, Virginia, where women in particular were starving and were feeling like their food supplies had been cut off. And so they went to the governor of Virginia, and presumably these were mostly white women, and who ignored them, and so they began to riot in Virginia, but in other southern places as well, because the cost of foods had become exorbitant during the war, right?
I think we're coming back to that time.
Yeah,
I
mean, yeah, yeah.
You know, right?
The cost of food, it's just... So, you know, many African American, by the time the war ended, first of all, for those who even knew the war had ended, and they were freed, whatever was available, they may have felt more likely to have access to it. I was sharing with the conveners of this session that in D.C., you may have had foods like the Hoppin' John right there. It may not obviously have looked as neat as it does here on this plate. But some of the other foods that were considered emancipation foods would have been, as I said, fried chicken. In this area, fried fish or some kind of fish, because you have access to the Potomac. You also may have had some kind of fritter here. Again, a lot of these supplies were in short, were not accessible at this time. I have oysters here because, again, with our proximity to the water.
Right, right. When I was reading about like the strawberry soda
and the red drinks,
the red drinks, but they tied it back to Galveston, Texas, because those were the slaves who were who realized that they were freed much later.
Right.
So was it with the soda something that they couldn't have? So when they were emancipated, they're like, we just want all the red drink we can have.
Now. Absolutely, that's certainly absolutely one interpretation. You know, I mean, I think remembering, and you and I talked about this, that part of changing that narrative, again, is that African-American people all ate scraps, right? That's what we hear. That's the dominant narrative, but that is actually not quite true, right? Slavery was a huge institution over multiple centuries. People lived in different places, then they were enslaved in different places from as far north as Maryland, right, and as far south as Florida and you know, Texas. So just by virtue of region, people had access to different things and did not have access to different things. So, for example, whereas you may have sassafras growing maybe in Galveston, in and around the Texas area, in this part of the region, if that was not available to you, you may have had mint or something like that. Okay. So I'm not saying at all that enslaved people ate high on the hog. That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is we have to explode this narrative that all African-American foods come from scraps.
Right.
Because you did have the ability. For example, if you had access to oysters, you may not have had the actual oyster, but you may have had what was left of the oyster, and you could use it with some water to now season a little bit differently.
To have like a gumbo or something like that.
A gumbo, but with the seasoning. So I think sometimes too, I mean, when I was working on building houses, people repeatedly said, African Americans cannot have access to chicken as often as you say, because it just wouldn't have been possible. And I'm like, but we're also not talking about a Purdue chicken cut up in a package.
Right.
We're talking about a yard bird. We're talking about something that you just, you know, that was roaming unpinned.
Did they want you to introduce the guinea hen? Or, I mean, what was the alternative?
And that's what I ended up doing.
Right.
I introduced, you know, familiarity with the guinea hen, but then also the yard bird.
Right.
And the fact that these birds may have been used for their eggs or cut up for to sell every single part of it, and they may have only eaten the liver or the gizzard, you know. So it's important for us to expand these conversations so that we're not pigeonholing, you know, African American people.
Well, speaking of that, and when I think about, so saying that the slaves didn't just have scraps. And they were stationary. When they were slaves, they were actually stationary, for the most part, unless they were sold off. Did they have gardens? And then after slavery was over, and they're moving, I mean, let's say after the Great Migration, the first Great Migration, the second Great Migration, and then maybe the gardens were no more because they were more migrant.
Right. I use this picture to sort of suggest exactly what you were saying. All we know about this wonderful image is this woman's name is Aunt Letty. I've tried to research extensively where this image would have been taken or what have you. I don't know where she got these vegetables from. Presumably, it could have been her own garden. It could have been that of someone else. But upon emancipation, she certainly would have had a little bit more liberty to do what she wanted to with this, right? I think she's here posing as a hawker or a huckster, right? Mm-hmm. So some African Americans had access to gardens. Some had plots, even upon emancipation, where even if you had land during the era of sharecropping, you had to use that land primarily for cotton. You could not use it to grow any of the vegetables. So you still had people with garden plots who starved. And then upon migration with the first, second, and so forth, as you move north into urban centers, of course, your lifestyle changed. You began to adopt different ways of eating and preparation. You know, we've left the farm.
Well, I think Aunt Letty is a good place to ask this next question because it kind of leads into that. Mm-hmm. Like, what roles did women play in advancing the liberation of African American people during the Civil War? And how does focusing on their roles with food speak to the political, social, and cultural elements of emancipation?
Right.
So, yeah, what role, I mean, as a woman, you know?
Right. You know, this is my favorite topic, actually. I'm really interested in the roles that women played. I think someone like Aunt Letty could have easily been associated with the Civil War. There are just a couple of images here that I found that actually had women in them. These women were washerwomen. You see, if you can see the wash tub there. And they were considered part of the contrabands at the Allen farmhouse. This African American man here, I think, has an axe, or maybe it's here who has an axe.
Uh-huh.
So the point is that, again, information was used and passed along, right? Here, you see over in the corner this woman right here who would have obviously probably served, unfortunately, in a number of violent capacities, being raped, you know, and so forth, but also certainly as cooking. And then I thought this was interesting, this African-American woman here outside the slave pen over in Alexandria, and she has the basket very similar to Aunt Letty. So, you know, selling foods, using the money for means of all kinds of purposes, right? Social, political, who knows what they may have been, paying people off, who knows?
Right.
So there are any number of ways that we can imagine. I have a note here about a woman who was mentioned, aside from being nurses, which we know quite a bit about, there was a woman who actually was a part of the Civil War, if I can just for one moment, I think I have one more page here. Mary Elizabeth Bowser, who they said is less known than Harriet Tubman, but was a spy. There's a full like 30 to 40 page essay I found on her, who worked with an urban spy ring. That's very, you know, 007-ish.
Exactly.
But she worked in an urban spy ring in the Confederate capital, and she was said to be the most productive espionage. This was said to be the most productive espionage operation in the Civil War. Apparently, she had a photographic memory. And she, when she assumed the identity of an illiterate slave woman and found a place as a house servant to the Confederate White House, she was able to gain access to lists of troop movements, reports on the location of Union prisoners, military strategies, and treasury reports.
Wow.
So an extensive amount of information. And she passed this along to Union forces until she was discovered, at which point she fled Richmond near the end of the war. So again, overlooking these stories, you know, and I like that story because she was a domestic.
But I love that story because I wonder where, and I don't know if you all are thinking this, what it makes me think of, how did they find this out about her? How did she transition into being a spy and finding out that she has a photographic memory to say, use me?
Right. Well, there's there were some, the people with whom she worked on the Union side left documents, and they left information, right? Because, of course, most African Americans weren't writing down these stories at this time, and so when, you know, her name appears repeatedly as the source of this information.
Wow.
You know, and again, I think the fact that she pretended to be illiterate, you know, but was able to access these reports and things with in such a way that she was able to manipulate the system.
Right. Wow. Wow.
Yeah.
So my next question goes to into what legacies with food historically exist today for women and for African American people in general. And are we thinking, I think this goes to what your new work is, are we thinking too small historically back, like to, because I'm from the South, and I think everybody puts us really in the South with Southern foods.
Right.
And it makes sense to me, but that's where I'm from.
Right.
But there are all of these other
Layers and so forth, yeah. Well, you know, I mean, I'm from Virginia, so I'm also from the South. And I'm familiar with my own sort of Southern Foodways repertoire. But again, the South is a big region. You know, it's a big region. And so the South in Virginia is not the South of Louisiana,
right?
You know? And a while ago, I worked on a piece on soul food, and I remember, you know, talking many years ago with, you know, Miss Leah Chase,
Dookie Chase's.
And she said, you know, when and we were at the Southern Foodways, you know, one of those gatherings, and she said, you know, if you come to Dookie Chase's, you're not going to get soul food, you're going to get Creole soul food,
right?
And so many of us forget, we go, we're looking for collard greens or the things we know, macaroni and cheese, succotash, whatever. And but there you may get etouffee and, you know, any of the other kinds of foods that are germane to that region. So that alone, and then you go to the South Carolina Lowcountry, you're going to get a different kind of foodstuffs, right? And then if you come up to Maryland, you may have more seafood-based kinds of food.
Right.
So again, remembering that we have broad palates.
But like I think people forget this because I think that when, and being on the chew, when I mention something that I had, and they're like, no, that's not how it is. It's just like, this is like, well, then where are you from?
Right.
Because that's
right.
the distinction. If
right.
I'm from Tennessee and you're from North Carolina, it's going to be totally different. And
we have
to honor everybody's food memories.
Absolutely.
But it's funny how we want ours to be the same.
Mm-hmm.
Like we're one group and it has to be a very narrow view of what historical.
Right. And part of that is, I think, born out of this kind of historical experience. You know, we have a shared historical experience of enslavement and then emancipation.
Right.
And we honor that and we understand that. But beyond that, this again goes back to what Coates was saying, the narrative tends to be so linear and so narrow that we keep repeating the same story. And so the things that, you know, you and I are trying to do is really to explode that. And we're up against, I think, a huge wall, because folks within community, African-American communities and outside, often are very reluctant to embrace anything other than the standard narrative. Some of it is because we have, you know, bell hooks said one of the ways that you get people to think poorly of themselves is you tell them the same narrative. Bell hooks said this, Barbara Christian. And so if you keep showing us the same images, then we're going to buy into those narratives.
Right.
And so if you keep telling us we come from scraps, then that's what we're going to think, you know. So then anything that comes from that is going to be demonized.
Right.
You know, scraps are bad. Soul food is bad.
Well, that brings me to the next point and the work that you're working on currently. And I love how you have a project titled Don't Yuck My Yum. You know, it's brilliant, right? Don't yuck my yum. Food shaming.
Right.
You know, let's talk about food shaming because, right. I mean, with the movie, Soul Food Junkies.
Soul Food Junkies, yes.
You know, and because if I can't honor my history through my food because I am embarrassed, then as a chef, where that leaves me as an African-American, I leave it for somebody else to do my food and make money off of it.
Right, and we talked about that. Yes, and that's absolutely on point. Again, that's part of the marketing ploy, right? Is if we can get you to be shamed by it, then when we come into New Orleans, we can reinvent it.
Right.
And now we've discovered it.
Exactly.
And now we're making money off of it, right?
Right.
And so, you know, again, my message is really to encourage African American communities to remove that stigma and that shame. The thing about Byron Hurt's Soul Food Junkies, and we understand part of his anger was because his father was dying. And he heavily attributed it. And for those of you who haven't seen it, it's a very interesting documentary. It's called Soul Food Junkies. By the title alone, you know, it really does put a lot of heavy lifting on this political term.
Yes.
Soul food, junk food,
things that you aren't supposed to eat, things you eat, you know, in moderation and don't honor.
And so some of the images in there of people just really in any culture, gorging themselves and having a good time in isolated incidents. They are tailgating, for example, and things of that nature. So he really attributes the overuse of sugar, salt, and fat, which if you're from the South, that's part of the Southern repertoire in many ways.
Yes, it is.
That's not particular to Black people.
Right, it's true.
Right, you know, cooking with whole butter and
and
that
then
nature,
everything
right?
sweeter. All
and
the desserts
sweeter.
Are sweeter.
Yeah, the sweet
except
tea.
The cornbread.
Except the cornbread, right? Still
don't
not
put any sugar,
don't
in,
put sugar in the cornbread. but you know, all of these foods. But then it's not until you get to the end, really, of the documentary, where he says, Byron Hurt says, it wasn't just the food, it was the social inequality.
Right.
And that's the part of the message that totally gets lost because of the food. And so we're not hearing that his father also suffered from racism, from systemic kinds of racism on the job and in society in the 70s, 80s, you know, so forth and so on. And all of that stress also led to his demise. And but that's not the part of the narrative that is front and center at all. It's the food. And so poor soul food, it has to do a lot of work in that documentary, you know, to recover.
Right.
And so then by extension, we as a people have to do a lot of work to justify the eating of foods that are consumed every day. And I told you this story of being at the Southern Foodways and going to one of their many spectacular events, and it was a pig ear. And, you know, I was like, whoa. This is a scrap, if you ask me. And I mean, but yet here it was being relished and folks were talking about the quality and the texture. And I was like, ugh. You know, I was like, okay. I mean, you see, okay. But you see it on the cover of Food and Wine.
Yes.
And now it's something to be, you know, savored.
I mean, you have all of these guys, you know, with bald heads and beards,
yes,
and tattoos.
And tattoos.
You know, celebrating, yes, this food,
yes,
and being celebrated for it.
Yes.
And researching,
yes,
this food,
yes,
and,
oh,
having,
right,
these amazing restaurants,
that's
serving,
right,
this food.
Right.
But if we cannot get past our this being shamed and embarrassed by this food, we're never,
right,
going to make money off of our own food.
No, that's
ever.
Right. And that's part of the enterprise, yeah, right, of emancipation.
Right.
Is having economic self-sufficiency.
Yes.
Right. That's,
yes,
part of the political agenda.
Yes.
And so coming out of this system where we were already behind, if you will, the one thing that we can capitalize on as a community of people is food. And yet, and that's one of the wonderful things about all of these men and women whose images I have here, during emancipation, during Reconstruction, the sort of nadir, the worst period of African-American history, African-Americans were thriving in catering. We established some of the best catering houses, right? And primarily because we were catering to other African-American,
right,
communities. The whole Philadelphia set.
Right.
Right. Thomas Bogle and so forth. I mean, they were amazing. We had hotels and boarding houses and so forth and so on. And we thrived off of our food. And then, you know, Jim Crow came into being. And so and at that time, because of the nostalgia for the Old South,
right,
they still very much wanted black caterers because they assumed that, you know, they cooked these foods the best. But then when Jim Crow came into being, all of that changed, and white supporters and patrons left African Americans in favor of others, and so those businesses began to decline. But prior to then, we were able to, like you said, make money off of our food.
But I think even in the hotel industry, if you don't see African American chefs owning their own restaurants, you see a lot of them in hotels.
Yes.
In restaurants in the back. They may,
right,
not own them, but they're the actual cooks.
Right. In some of those instances today, although more and more increasingly, we're starting to see Latino peoples,
yes,
in those kitchens because, again, with the civil rights movement, we wanted to move out of those domestic spaces into other kinds of industries. And now behind the kitchen door, if you will, they tend to be Latino men and women,
uh-huh,
mostly men, actually.
Right.
Many of those.
So when you talk about what the work that you're working on now, African American, mm-hmm, food dilemmas, and we're talking about emancipation, and I guess in my head, I mean, you can be physically emancipated,
mm-hmm,
but to get, I think what we're talking about now is to be mentally
emancipated.
Emancipated. And there's so many of us who are still there. And so it's like, what has to happen for us to make the jump from here to here?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, that's all right. You know, I mean, I think we have to keep having these conversations. The work you're doing on the Chew and in other public spaces and with your cookbooks in your restaurant to change the face of that story.
Right.
You do have, as we were talking earlier, places like Farmer Brown's and others that are, these are restaurants that are trying to bring back healthy soul food,
yeah,
right?
That's
healthy
it.
Soul food,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
But there are, you know, generations of people who, in my interview, said, "If it's not fried, it's not soul." And there's a place that has to be given to that, though.
But how much frying did we do really before?
Exactly.
The Great Migration.
Right.
So
before
we started,
we got, I mean, access to,
right,
that.
Exactly. Right.
Exactly.
We weren't frying.
We weren't necessarily frying, and we,
right,
weren't frying. Deep frying necessarily.
Right.
We just didn't have access. No, we weren't, definitely weren't deep frying our pickles. No, if we could even get a pickle, we were eating it right, and just like in cucumber form.
Okay, right, exactly.
Right. So, I mean, some of this extra frying and so forth is part of the invention and ingenious of cooking. Okay, and again, you don't want to take that away from people.
Correct.
But with everything, there's moderation.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Even moderation, as I forgot his name, who says that? It'll come to me.
Mm-hmm.
50.
Okay.
That's all I'm gonna say.
Yeah, right.
If you understand, you understand.
Yeah, you got that.
But I mean, one of the things that I want to do in my restaurant, because I do want to hold on to my history, and it will be fried chicken and southern sides. Yeah. All the sides will be vegetarian, because I do have to change the way that we eat our food, but I don't want to lose the tradition of our food.
That's right.
And it's about honoring my grandmothers who cooked this food, mm-hmm. but also being in the 21st century.
Right.
It's not either or.
No, it's not. It can't be. You know, this is, and we talked about this, is such a big conversation that to reduce it to either or, I think says that, again, we are limited in who we are. But we're creative and inventive peoples. We have to be, right?
Yeah.
And so there are all kinds of ways that you can make this food. You know, I'll tell this really quick story that's going to be in my book. I went to a Black History Month presentation a while ago, and it was, I'll skip over the first part just to get to the real heart of this story. One of the dishes that was served was greens, collard greens. And there was a woman sitting beside us who just went on and on about, oh my God, these are the best greens. I just need someone to teach my mother-in-law that you don't need all that pork, and this is great. It melts in your mouth. So when the chef came out, African-American chef who happens to be vegan, and he was saying, you know, so she raised her hand and she said, you know, how did you cook these greens? Because I have got to get rid of this pork. And he said, well, they're not really collard greens, first of all. And he named off five different kinds of plants that were in there, right? From carrot tops to, you know, all kinds of things. Then he went on to say, and the night before, I soaked them in black truffles.
And we weren't frying those either.
Talk about the blank stare, you know. No, this was crazy. She had no idea what that was, so she didn't know.
Right, what a truffle was.
What the truffle was, right. He went in the back and got it, and of course, pinched off a tiny piece.
And she got to smell it, she was like,
oh! Yes, but it's so unattainable for the average person.
Yeah, right, absolutely, right.
So
right.
Now she has thrown her cultural history under the bus, totally just done away for something that's unattainable.
Right. Right. Because I would have told her, if I was there, I'd say, girl, what you need to do is get yourself some smoked paprika.
That's it.
Some onions, some chilies. I mean, because it's just the smokiness.
There are other ways
that are so approachable.
Right.
That is, and I think when people understand what it is you're missing.
Yes.
So you take one smoky thing out, you know, it could be, and you replace it with another.
Right. And that's what we're saying.
Yeah.
See, so it's not a... either or, it's another way of thinking through your palate. And if we really wanted to honor our history,
then
you would think along those lines of invention, because without access to the smokiness, you know, those folks are hoeing all day long and cottoning all day long, thinking, how am I going to, you know, what am I going to do next? Or if you're in the kitchen and you are cooking multiple meals, as I've been talking with some colleagues here, and you've got to cook for multiple people, and you're thinking, okay, how am I going to stretch this, that, and the other, so I'm not, you know, now in some grave danger from the missing. You're thinking along the lines of invention. So what I need for us to do as people is to, again, not go with the either or. If it's either pork or it's going to be, but think about how you can get different tastes and flavors, and as I'm learning from Foods Channel, taste profiles, and expand your palate to derive, and you know, being inventive with these foods, right?
Yeah. So, I mean, I think we've been talking about it, the foods that speak to the legacies of freedom and how we communicate them and the importance of them today.
Right.
So what would those foods be?
I think they range. This is a really good image of, you see in the back, ham and eggs and coffee. This is of a woman in Philadelphia probably making pepper pot soup, you know, which would have maybe had tripe and, you know, tomatoes and onions and so forth. But those legacies are just that. I mean, she's selling this food that she's familiar with. And this would have been around 1870 or so forth. But it's a precursor to the kinds of conversations we're having right now in the work you do, right?
Right.
Doing your own thing. Honoring your history and your culture. And what I like about this image is She seems to be serving these African-American men. And in building houses, you know, I talk about that community of women in Gordonsville, Virginia, who sold chicken and other foodstuffs. I mean, in Harper's Weekly, they talk about it being pies and cakes and hot coffee and egg. I mean, the list is so extensive. And they sold it at the train tracks. But what the part that I didn't know when I wrote the book is that the food that was left over at the end of the week, they gave it out in the community to those who didn't have. So there's this story there of uplift, of community agency, of activism, of, like you said, honoring the history.
Right.
But we've always been a people of uplift, right?
Right. Right.
And that's exactly what I think this image suggests to me, which is why, one of the reasons that I included it. So doing things with food that are expansive, but yet that speak to the process of emancipation, which for African-American people began in the 1600s when we were enslaved.
Right.
It was always ever a process of how do I get out of bondage, right? So it didn't start in 1865.
Right.
I would back it up two centuries to talk about how the moment you become enslaved, you're always ever thinking about freedom.
Right, right, mm-hmm. Right. Is there anything that you want to bring up that I didn't ask you?
I think we've covered it. This is an image of a Baltimore Arabber, which is another tradition that has now gone the way of zoning and regulation because they could no longer have the horses and come around to people's homes and sell these foods. Now, of course, we have food trucks.
Right. Yeah.
That may sell fresh fruit and vegetable.
I remember the guy coming around my grandmother's house in a truck,
yes.
driving around
yes.
the neighborhood. And I think they're trying to bring that back. I think DC Central Kitchen mm-hmm. is trying to do
yes.
something like that, just to have fresh vegetables
right.
in areas.
Put them in different wards, right?
Absolutely.
Ward 6 and Ward 7 yeah. in DC. They're trying to bring these fresh fruits and vegetable trucks. You've got Peaches and Green up in Detroit.
Mm-hmm.
For these spaces. And so again, we have to have this conversation on this level, the historical, on the level at which you were operating, at the point of the food gardens and so forth. And there are just so many different ways that Black people enter this conversation
right.
and can change it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if we become a little bit more informed about our history and then have a vision for our future.
Right. Does anybody have any questions? Yeah, we have. Okay. So we have.
The mic.
Okay.
So mic's coming around.
Okay. Oh, I might have taken it off.
Can you hear me?
Can you?
Is that on?
Yeah, it's on.
Okay. To back up again, just in case I took it off. I'm sorry.
Mm-hmm. I wanted to ask it on the flip side of the food shaming
mm-hmm.
seems to me should be a great deal of pride
mm-hmm.
in the many things. I mean, most people come to this country by choice, or many of them do.
Right.
African Americans were brought here not by choice,
right.
but they still came with so many traditions and
right.
food traditions that have become such a part of all that were adapted to the various places they
right.
lived in the South. They introduced foods that mm-hmm. had never been seen here.
Yeah.
And I wonder how much that's been acknowledged and how much more it could be, you know, exploited. And it's just so interesting.
Right. You know, there's a handful of us who are doing this work. Jessica Harris, Fred Opie, Michael Twitty, you know, the list sort of, you know, Howard Page. But there's not nearly enough who are telling these stories of the contributions of African Americans to American cuisine, right? And because there are so few of us, there's a lot of work to be done.
Right.
That's what I'm saying, yeah.
Psyche, what are some of the foods that were introduced?
There are different types of foods. Okra, we know, peanuts, of course, those are probably the two most popular, right? But there were also some tubers that were, because of course the yam.
Right. But even the cultivation of rice in the Carolinas.
The cultivation of rice in the Carolinas. And that's what I was going to say. It's also, too, it's not just the actual food, but it's the preparation and also the cultivation of the foods, the planting side. And, you know, this is the other thing I like to remind people, that slavery was both an economic system and a racial system. And I think we forget that. And the economics often gets lost.
Right.
Right? You know, those enslaved people, particularly when you had the formal slave trade, weren't just brought to this country willy-nilly. They were brought because of certain skill sets that they had, right? Traders went to certain areas of the continent of West Africa and brought people from the Bight of Biafra or Nigeria or Ghana based on those skill sets, like the cultivation of rice and the growth of indigo, dye. So we have to remember those economics, right? And that they brought people here because they knew how to harvest and plant cotton or tobacco or things of that nature.
Mm-hmm. After you, then we go over here.
Okay. Thank you so much for this. It's so provocative. I have about 100 questions. I'm just going to ask you two,
okay.
Please. Can you, it seems to me from a situation of scarcity, mm-hmm. not necessarily scraps, but mm-hmm. scarcity in terms of what you can get.
Right.
So that when you're thinking about sustenance, celebration, mm-hmm. all the way that food is in our lives, that it takes a certain creativity to work with a very, very limited, or
Absolutely.
To come up with that kind of creativity. Do you see, what are examples of that from 150 years ago? And are those, is that still present, that type of, has that come down the line, mm-hmm. that kind of creativity?
Mm-hmm. You want to take this?
Well, I would say yes, it comes mm-hmm. down the line. I mean, and not just in food, I think in fashion, I think in dancing, I think like in rhythms, and I think it's still happening. But you also still see where something that is created in our community, as soon as, and it's not valued, but as soon as somebody else does it in another community, it's given a new name and valued. And I think that we're like, what? And I'm just gonna use twerking. Okay. I know, sorry for the video, I'm just gonna use twerking. No, just because in our community, it was called booty popping. And we've been doing it forever. But then when Miley Cyrus does it, I was like, oh, there's this new dance called twerking. I mean, the braids, Bo Derek, they've been doing mm-hmm. braids
Remember
all the
that?
Time.
Yeah.
You know, it would be really cool on somebody coming, a white person coming from Jamaica, but if we wear them, it's like, why is your hair in those braids? I don't want you to wear that at work. So I think we see it in a lot of different areas. It's, but I also think, I believe in energy, and if we don't own it, and we give it away, and we give the power away, it leads us open for somebody to say, it's not okay on you,
That's
but
right.
I'm going to take it and make it into something great.
What she said. But also, just to add to that, though, but something like chitlins, which initially were, the whole reason, of course, that the term soul food came about is because of an article written, one of the reasons is an article written in a New York paper where it said, the Negro has no culture. And Amiri Baraka, who at the time was Leroy Jones, responded and listed all the various ways, dance, music, art, but also food. And he chronicled the foods that come out of the South that we have done interesting things with. And what was happening at that time, you had the beet culture and so forth in New York. People were grabbing hold of these foods and renaming them and calling them delicacies. And he was like, this is a Sunday dinner, you know, in black culture. So that's exactly what you're talking about, this misappropriation or trying to reappropriate black cultures. But in terms of those substitutions down the line, I was married to a Ghanaian man, and whenever he ran out of fufu, he would use cream of wheat. And so these sort of substitutions just become everydayness. You know, it's not over the top.
It's so funny that you mentioned that, because mm-hmm. when I think of hot water cornbread, and mm-hmm. I was talking to a woman from Nigeria, and she's mentioning fufu, the ground cassava.
Right, ground cassava or millet.
Mm-hmm. Stews.
Mm-hmm. Yes, absolutely.
And I was like, wait, that's our hot water cornbread.
Right.
It's just fried.
It's just fried.
And I'm like, and when you make that connection, it is so powerful and amazing, and how you feel a connection to the people from the continent, and you're like,
cultural continuity.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. So can you give the mic to him? Oh, I'm sorry.
One more question.
Sorry, John.
He said he had 100. He's only limited to two. Okay.
Okay. Take us back 150 years ago, mm-hmm. Emancipation Day. Mm-hmm. There are celebrations that involving food. Mm-hmm. In this area, I'm not talking
right.
Just say right in Maryland, D.C., right here. Mm-hmm. And we're here, and we're at a table. Mm-hmm. What would be on it?
That's a good question. Hard to know, hard to tell. I mean, it could just be what you had access to at that moment, some kind of spam. It could have been you only had access to water. You may have had hardtack. It could have been any beans. Could have been on your table. I just want to show this image here of some of those foods that were typical during the Civil War. And this is based on a PBS piece that was done on Civil War cooking. You may have only had biscuits.
What would have been they really dressed? Were they dressed up anything that was like really put in an extra work or any? What was a celebratory?
That's okay.
I'm
going to answer this, and maybe it'll feed into someone else's question. But I think I would say it like this. I want us to move away from sort of the contemporary celebration moment. You've been enslaved for all of your life. You find out that you are free, or that the war has ended and you are free. You may not eat at all.
Right.
You may not be able to breathe.
Right.
Because you don't even know what that means for you.
Right.
So freedom for you at that moment could just be breath in life.
Right.
You may not even know which way to walk.
Right.
You know, what do you do?
Right, right.
So I want us to think in terms of not necessarily jubilation. Yay. That's why you have Juneteenth.
Right.
Because the folks in Galveston, Texas didn't know for almost a year or more that they were free. Right. So what we celebrate today, even as I was writing this information for one of the conveners and asking me, you know, all I could think of was just breath. It may just be being able to take a cup of water without being watched.
As you were saying that, I mean, my legs feel like they could just fall over. I feel like I could just fall over because that is so powerful when you go back and you think that. I mean, you're like, what? Mm-hmm. I mean, I would just be like probably wandering and just sitting, you know, I don't have to get up from this chair. I'm just going to sit right here.
Right.
You know, because it's my choice.
Right. Because it's your choice. And where is your wife? Where are your children?
Yeah.
Where's your mama and your daddy?
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I imagine not being able to eat for some time, quite honestly, because you're overwhelmed with joy, with sadness.
But also, what does it mean? Where are you going? You don't have a place to live. What does that mean?
Well, and there are images in this cache of people in boats, with the ruins of a city behind them. I didn't include it here, but it hit me when I was looking at it, and I was like, yeah, where do you go?
Right.
They're just sitting in the river, in a boat, with everything they own,
right.
in a blanket.
Basically.
Yeah. Where do you go? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I'm glad you brought up chitlins, because I was about to go there.
Okay.
But speaking of food shaming, can you talk about pig's feet?
Mm-hmm.
And then talk about sweet potato pie, because I cannot do pumpkin pie.
Okay. Right. Well, you know, let me just tell you a quick story about a student who I have the pleasure of working with who said she was food shamed when she arrived at a Thanksgiving dinner a year ago, and the host, she brought a hostess gift, and the host said, oh, what is it? And she says, pumpkin pie. And the woman looked at her and said, who eats pumpkin pie? You must not be black, you know? And so, I mean, she had the opposite because she was like, I didn't realize that there was a protocol, you know, that she was supposed to bring sweet potato pie instead.
We talked about that on the Chew.
Yes.
They were like, and then we have pumpkin pie. I'm like, oh, whoa, 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 whoa. No, we don't. We have sweet potato.
Sweet potato.
Right, that's so funny. Yeah.
Right.
Okay. Well, first of all, I want to thank you guys for this because I'm originally from Houston. Mm-hmm. So half of my family's from Texas, my mother's side and my father's side from Louisiana. Mm-hmm. So our dinners are very interesting. Yes. We don't know if we're going to have soul food or we're going to have gumbo.
Right.
So it's like just all over right. the place, which is actually like just the best of both worlds,
right.
you know.
Right.
But the whole thing with food shaming, I'm just so glad that I came to this talk because when I go home sometime for holidays, my brothers and my mom, my father's not here anymore, but we're like, oh, we shouldn't eat this and we shouldn't eat that. Mm-hmm. And it's because of somewhat of the media that
yes.
we've been listening to
yes.
saying that's not that. But what I realized is when I went home is that my mother said, we're going to cook differently. Mm-hmm. And actually, she started cooking very differently when my father had a heart attack.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it was the same food that we always had. But I just wondered, and I still ask her to this day, how did you learn to season the food without the salt?
Sure.
And it was like she did it overnight, and we never knew about it.
Right.
So
right.
when you ask about the thing about changing from the sassafras to the whatever mm-hmm. root,
yes.
and she discovered that thing, and I'm just now, it just brings back those memories. So
yes.
thank you guys for doing this talk.
Good. Thank you. Yeah. You know, I talk about this in Building Houses that I have a chapter in this book on the film Soul Food, right? For those of you who may remember, the film Soul Food came out about 10 years ago, and it was a celebration of the continuation of the Sunday dinner amidst the death of the matriarch of the family. And so my chapter is called I'm Still Dying for Some Soul Food, because my bigger point is that folks celebrated the movie being very comfortable, unfortunately, with the fact that the mother had died. You know, we were okay with that and just kept on going because we were focused on the food. The piece about the film that sort of was upsetting to me is that none of those women changed. Those daughters never changed the way they prepared that food in honor of their mother. The problem is, you cannot eat that kind of food and not work out and be as beautiful as they remain in that movie, right? Because your other things are going to creep in. So my point is there were some slight tweaks that could happen. My father was diagnosed with diabetes, 60 years ago, probably 55 years ago. And like you, overnight, you know, peas appeared more frequently on our table, tuna fish. We had meatless nights, you know, so meatless Monday was meatless any day of the week, you know, both for scarcity, but also because wheat bread instead of white bread, and subtle changes, but changes nonetheless that have no doubt prolonged his life. But also, like you said, it wasn't missed.
Right.
It really wasn't. I mean, and perhaps there may be an occasional pork chop here and there, but we just got to the point where our palate just all of a sudden changed.
Right.
And you adapt.
Right, you adapt.
We adaptive people. We are in general. And the only other thing I want to say about the food shaming is it's not just African-American communities.
Oh. It's Hispanic communities.
It's in every community.
Every culture has
right.
it.
Every culture has it. I'm focusing particularly on African-American because I'm tying it back to this larger discussion. But I was out in the Midwest, and I had, over the course of the couple of days that I was speaking there, three different groups of women came to me and told me that they were glad that I had said what I said because they felt food shamed. One was a set of Asian American twins who said that once they had gotten to that campus, they had stopped eating chicken. Therefore, they hadn't had their traditional family food in 3 years. Because no one there ate the chicken mixed with other kinds of sauces and things that they were used to. And so, I mean, talk about tears being brought to your eyes. I mean, that sort of social acceptance
right.
around food
right.
that would cause you to just totally deny who you are as a person, so such an integral part of your identity.
Yeah. Is she going?
Okay.
It will be first, you next with the, yes, everybody here. I just want you to know she's next.
Okay.
a comment on the food shaming. It's mm-hmm. interesting. It's not my question, but in Italy, they talk about cucina povera, the mm-hmm. food of poverty.
Mm-hmm.
And so some restaurants now will actually state on that this is like pasta with breadcrumb sauce. Mm-hmm. I mean, how more basic can you get than that?
Mm-hmm.
But it's delicious.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe there is still some shame there. I don't know. But
right.
I thought that was interesting.
Mm-hmm.
But on the mall, there is this building going up, the African American History Museum. Mm-hmm. And I assume there'll be a cafeteria.
Mm-hmm.
And what would you hope to see them serving at the museum?
Mm-hmm. Great. Yeah, someone just told me about this the other day. Apparently, they do have some chefs coming in consulting on this project.
I'm one of them.
Uh-huh, and you are, right, you are. You're the one that was telling me that. Yeah, we talked about that. Someone told me, and you told me. So then she can answer this question.
No, but I will be one of the chefs. They're trying to have a representation of all of the different kinds of foods that that Psyche has talked about. But I said to Psyche, did they come to you with the research? Because it's so important to get it historically correct and to broaden people's perceptions of what these foods are. And it's ever changing, just like the Museum of the American Indian. So it'll be... and that restaurant is doing very well. I don't know when it's going to open, but they're putting a lot of thought into it.
Right.
Next year?
Yeah, it's 2017, right?
Yeah.
2016.
Yeah, where are we, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Madam.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you so much. Am I on?
You're on.
It's a very exciting moment for us over here. I may pass the mic to my spouse here afterwards as well. But I just want to thank you first, Ms. Hall and Dr. Williams-Forson, for shining a spotlight on this really important issue. A brief comment and one question. I'll mm-hmm. limit myself. One is that I'm very familiar with the work of, as I'm sure a number of us are here, of Byron Hurt. So the mm-hmm. the good news there is that when it comes to issues of African-American masculinity, sexuality, homophobia, this gentleman, as a filmmaker and as a researcher, is shining a light. So mm-hmm. I guess he's done, I haven't seen this documentary in particular,
mm-hmm.
but I guess he's done the same thing mm-hmm. with Foodways.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm very interested to hear more about both in your commercial sort of real estate kitchens mm-hmm. and in the media and at our kind of white-collar dinner parties, how you counter the narrative that everything that is gluten and wheat and meat and, in my mind, food-based mm-hmm. is challenging or is something that is worth shaming. That's a challenge I see a lot socially where you can actually no longer as comfortably gather around food because of so many of these limitations.
So many different limitations.
I'm of a generation where I didn't see or know about the many, many shellfish and peanut and nut allergies. I guess I'm so very fortunate that I... Mm-hmm. Hay fever, and that's it.
Right, exactly.
But there are so many young people, very young mm-hmm. people, and, millennial age folks who are very mm-hmm. sensitive to various foods that it makes it very, very difficult to gather around foods of any sort.
Yes.
mm-hmm. Ethnic or not. And mm-hmm. so I'm just interested to hear both on a commercial level from you, Ms. Hall, and sort of on an academic level how mm-hmm. to sort of counter that narrative or how to respond to it.
Mm-hmm.
I think that now that I have it, I'm gonna let it go. I think that people want to feel included. They want to feel thought of. But I mean, anybody, it's just like I hear you, I see you, I care about what your issues are. So somebody who is gluten free, it is not necessarily a healthy option. They physically cannot have gluten. Those that are celiac. So there are some who are doing it for a healthy thing. It's harder to produce things for people who are very sensitive because you are in kitchens where there is flour. And a molecule of flour could make them sick. So that is really hard. So they have to go to special places. I know in my restaurant we won't do any nuts because my partner's children can't have nuts. So we've decided that we will have a nut-free kitchen. When you are doing an event or party, what I suggest is that you have signs in your food, either it's gluten-free, vegan, or whatever, just little signs so people know what they can eat. a lot of times people who can eat everything can still enjoy those things. But you are basically trying to balance what the others cannot have. So that's how you would deal with it, like on a personal level at a party. The reason that I've chosen to make my sides vegetarian is because I will have chicken and sides. So if you're vegetarian, the only thing you can eat at my restaurant are the sides, and they will be true vegetarian. A lot of times people don't get it, and so they like it's a vegetable soup with chicken stock, you know? And I can't, what is the deal? It is not vegetarian, you know? And I take this so seriously. Well, I don't understand why you're saying this is a vegetarian. Yes, a vegetarian soup. Oh, but it is, has chicken stock. So I think it's trusting where you actually, the source, trusting the source, the same place that you're going to trust where you get your meat or your fish or anything else. You have to trust the restaurant that you can, they are telling you the truth about that food and what is and what isn't in it. And so, and I take that very seriously. And so, and the restaurants that I go to people that I trust, because you may not be able to eat something, shellfish or whatever, but there is cross-contamination in the back. And so you have to have people who understand that and keep everything separately.
So this is a big question, because it operates at a lot of different levels. It operates at a level of power, and it operates at a level of accommodation, as you've heard here. And at the level of power, I wrote this short piece about how I was once on a diversity committee and with a colleague of mine, and none of our suggestions were taken. We were pretty much, I think, there as placeholders. But at any point, this is many, many years ago when I was first entering academia and higher ed, the provost at that time invited us. No, she told us she was having a celebration for the ending of this body of work, and that and we were invited, which we knew meant we were supposed to be there, right? So we get there and we're waiting for the meal, and so then she said, "Okay, food is served." This was in the late 80s. She had made tofu kebabs. Right, tofu kebabs. This was in the era.
It was a tofu marinated, pressed.
It was nothing.
Oh.
And this was before tofu became what it is today.
Right.
It was just tofu.
Right.
And so, you know, my other colleague said to me, "What is this? What are we eating?" And I said, "Power. You're eating power." She had the right to do it, and she did. And the rest of us were left eating chips for that meal, right? So there are ways that you can present these kinds of things as a power, right? I'm a vegetarian, and that's all I'm serving at my wedding. Even though I've invited 100 plus guests, it's all vegetarian, you know. Now you've wasted your money because, you know.
But that's really interesting because as a caterer, I had those clients. Mm-hmm. And so knowing that there were going to be other people there, I'm like, how can we make this food so that everyone will enjoy it?
Inclusion.
Right.
Inclusion.
Yeah.
So that's why I said you've got those kinds of power dynamics. Then there's the other piece about accommodating everyone, potluck everyone brings and labels. But then there's another level at which this conversation is about access and affordability. What if that's all you have access to? I have not encountered, and this could just be for whatever reason, a number of people who are food insecure, yeah, who also tell me they are nut, gluten, and have all these other issues. Now, I don't know. It just dawned on me that that's interesting. I don't know what that's about. Other than maybe they haven't been diagnosed yet, but most of the people who I've encountered and worked with who are food insecure, maybe in the elderly community are diabetic or have hypertension or something like that. Along the student community, which is what I'm dealing with right now, maybe international or something like that. But very seldom do I encounter people who have difficulty just accessing basic food on a regular basis, having these various delineations. So that's why I said it's a complicated question on so many different levels. Class factors into there, socioeconomics. Generally, when we think in terms of class, we think providing for people who are high blood pressure and hypertensive and things of that nature. So it I agree. It operates on a lot of different levels, though. Inclusion and accommodation.
Thank you, guys. I think we're about
at our time.
Is that what you're going to tell us?
Oh, we have time for one more question. No.
You have the mic.
You have the mic. You must.
We're not
going to.
Okay. Last question.
Won't leave without hearing from you.
Awesome. Thank you. Thank you. My mom, she's 87, born in the sharecropping, mm-hmm. been on dialysis for 20 plus years. And so she definitely epitomized soul food cooking for us. Mm-hmm. In the last 20 years of her being on dialysis, the two big changes that I've seen in her cooking and learning from her, well, I guess three. One, salt intake greatly reduced, mm-hmm. Much more extensive use of herbs. Mm-hmm. And then secondly was the reduction of Crisco to just use simply butter, which I think is kind of ironic because
it's natural.
In Europe,
okay.
The French,
it's natural.
Yes, it's natural. And we've loved it. And my second oldest brother, he's become lactose intolerant. Mm-hmm. So to the question about sweet potato pie, she's incorporated coconut milk. So mm-hmm. it's to your point about the adaptation, because
yes.
her ultimate secret is, I like to say it's improvisation of jazz, because it's the pinch. I'm like, how do you
yeah.
measure that pinch?
Yes.
How do you know to put in there? She's like, it's just a touch, child. It's just
right.
a touch.
Great.
A tinch.
So I just in awe, and so I feel like I've grasped a little of that, and so I just wanted to make that comment. My question to both of you all is, we've been extensive travelers, and so think of in Brazil, mm-hmm. The contributions to feijoada.
Ah, yes.
And
yeah.
it's mm-hmm. the national dish of Brazil.
Yes, mm-hmm. yes.
The contribution of the African slaves there
yes,
is
the rice embraced. And the beans, and you guys have mm-hmm, cool mm-hmm. sauces for it. Mm-hmm.
So how can we cultivate that kind of reverence in our country? And part of it, I sometimes think, is maybe through entrepreneurship, because on, let's see, Chopped, brother from my wife's borough, Boogie Down Bronx, he mm-hmm. won, and he said, these 10 stacks make me, you know, feel nicely. And if you know that, you know it.
Mm-hmm.
But he had said that cooking saved him. Mm-hmm. And I guess, like, how do we kind of help to cultivate this mm-hmm. of embracing our culture contributions when it's, like, world-renowned in many places? Mm-hmm.
Well, cooking saved him.
I think cooking saves a lot of people. I think the kitchen, it's the place of second chances. It's a level playing field. I don't care if you come from an expensive culinary school or you've come out of prison. We just need somebody to get the job done. And, I mean, at the end of the day, it's about getting the job done and how well and how quickly and how efficiently you can do it. So I think the food world wasn't always this. I mean, there weren't celebrity chefs, you know, 20 some years ago. Mm-hmm. It was just all about getting food to the people, and it's a blue collar job. So I think that now because of food television, I think that we are eating more different foods. There are truffles in our greens. Mm-hmm. we are broadening our horizons and sharing, because this world is very small. And I think we are sharing, because of food television, there are probably a lot more dishes that in our community that people know that they didn't know before. And we have to honor that. And a lot more food TV. And we're fascinated with food. And I think it is because of, you know, food television.
And at the same time, on food television, there are times that you notice that those very basic, common foods don't get as celebrated as the most creative kinds of things. They don't. And that's, so it works
yes.
both ways. It expands our
yes.
repertoire, but it forecloses on it at the same time.
Hey, do we have time for me to say one thing? I know you're trying to go home.
It forecloses on it at the same time.
Yes.
But rice and beans, you know, whether it's Brazil or whether it's wache in Ghanaian cultures, right? Or Hop and John, right?
Yes.
It's still rice and some kind of
yes.
bean, you know, and yet it's considered peasant food.
Yes. But the peasant food is amazing. And I remember
it's
there
amazing.
Was, we had a cook-off on the Chew. I don't know if those of you all who watched this, there was a cook-off on the Chew, and I was cooking up against Clinton Kelly, and I said, I know exactly what I'm going to do. I'm going to do my grandmother's braised collard greens and hot water cornbread, and I'm going to share the love of my granny with everybody at the tasting table. Okay, that was my dish. I was like, I put in the love. I went, taste it. It was like, it was so good. Clinton Kelly said, oh, that morning, what am I going to do? I think I'm just going to do broccoli, throw in some cheese. He did a broccoli cheese casserole. How pedestrian. And I'm not saying anything on the video. I'm not saying anything that I wouldn't say to him. All right. But, and he said to me, why would you take your grandmother's dish that you felt so connected to, your heart was so connected to it, and let these people judge it, because they did not get it. They didn't understand it in his broccoli cheese casserole one. Yes, I was just like, I was so hurt. I was so hurt. I swear, I tried to laugh really hard until I cried, but the tear was really first. But I said, I had one little tear. I was hurt. I was really hurt because it meant so much to me that I wanted them to understand my food, to say, I see you, I get you, I care what you're thinking and giving me. Mm-hmm. And they didn't.
No. Yeah.
So to that point.
Yes, to that point.
Please
but
take
you
a
guys,
moment.
Next time I'll make all you guys green.
Thank you. Thank you.
Restaurants.
Right.
Thank you to these lovely ladies, and don't forget to get their books out there. I'm sure they'll stick around for a moment and sign a copy for you. Thank you all.
Thank you, thank you,
thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.